Hello. Welcome to our interview conversation with Pamela Boyd-Sim. This is being produced by Grassroots Economic Organizing and by another little project that I'm beginning, which is called the Growing Democracy Project. That was not really up on its feet yet, but it will be soon. So we're going to be doing this in three parts. And the first part is just talking with Pamela about who she is and what her project is about. It's kind of an overview of it. Part two will be going into a more detailed discussion of the project. And then part three, be exploring some of the questions that her work stimulates. So, Pamela, hello.
Hi, Michael.
It's good to be talking.
With you.
Good to be talking to you again. We've had many conversations over the last 3 years since we first met. And there's been a question that I've always wanted to ask, and this seems like a really good occasion to do that. You have brought many things into your life, combined them. You're Black, female, a Buddhist, a Quaker, done a lot of facilitating and training work, and you're steeped in neurology and quantum mechanics and digital physics. How did all of this come together in your life, your being, your person? I think that'd be a fascinating thing to hear.
Well, it is the drive or the impulse to understand that I'm none of those things that brought all of that together. All of those things, all of those aspects that you mentioned are egoic constructs. They are personas. They are sheaths that allow me to relate to the world and the world of form, but none of them have anything to do with who I am. They are just vehicles through which I connect to the world, at least in the world of form.
Okay.
They came about very organically, very naturally, and there's a lot of overlap. I try to do things that maximize the use of my time. So all of the things that you mentioned are very harmonious ways of relating to the world, but none of them are me.
But they do come together harmoniously. For example, how does Quaker and quantum mechanics come together?
Well, that gets to the pith of the entire conversation we're having here. They're early Quakers, and Quakers, a certain swath of Quakers to date, use as their practice connection with the undifferentiated field, also known as the quantum field. Quakers call it light. Christians call it God. It is also universal intelligence. So every time a Quaker enters a meeting house or just as they walk around in their lives, the intent is to live into, to be in contact with that more vast dimension of themselves. And that is what informs Quaker meetings, Quaker communities, Quaker activism, Quaker life, the ongoing connection with the quantum field. So that's a very direct connection between Quakerism and quantum physics.
Right. Okay. And that seems also how the connection to Buddhism would be also.
It is precisely the same connection. The reason why the two of those traditions are in my life are because the Buddhists have more recently done social activism in the way Quakers do it. So the combination of the two brings together activism that is potentized by ongoing connection with the quantum field. Both Buddhism and Quakerism as practiced by early Quakers and a certain percentage of Quakers at the moment.
Okay. So is it like you're doing kind of a reinterpretation of Quakerism or refreshing of it or something?
It's the work that I do in the Quaker world is just to bring people's attention back to the heart, the fire, and the pith of what Quakerism always has been about. But just like anything, over time, the original content is eroded, and societies in which traditions that take us to the vastness of who we are, the societal environment erodes that. So my work in the Quaker world revolves around reminding people of what Quakerism sprung from, was initially, and everyone can be now if the swath of Quakers that is still considers themselves mystical, if that number grew, if that percentage grew.
Okay. I just need to make a note that there is, we are having some kind of a technical difficulty. I'm at least seeing that Pamela's speaking and the sound that's coming are not quite synchronized. And we'll try to adjust that after part one. And you've pulled all of this together into your project, which is Inner Landscapes, Activist Community of Practice. And it's like you seem to have integrated Buddhism, Quakerism, and neuro-linguistic programming, at least, into a very specific approach that is focused on activists. And so if you could talk about how you integrated that, it gives a kind of an outline picture of it, it would be great.
Sure, there are some baselines that bring these things together. The first baseline is practitioners come into this with some kind of understanding of the fact that we are non-material beings, that what is seems to be material is an infinitesimally small part of who we are. So people that come into the community of practice from whatever traditions they've been in or whatever intuitive knowing or wherever they have been exposed to the fact that the physical universe is, there's so much more than that. So non-materiality is the first point of focus. The second pillar is neural plasticity, and that's understanding that the brain, the circuitry of the human brain is plastic, it is malleable, it's like Play-Doh, it's like silly putty, and we have the capacity to do whatever we choose with that to have it serve us. If we live unexamined lives, life, the good stuff, the bad stuff, all of the healthy things, the unhealthy things, it all imprints willy-nilly on that silly putty, that modeling clay that is the circuitry of the brain. If we're not looking at it, if we're not resolving that, all of the unhealthy material that does not serve us is imprinting there. We can shift that. We can change that. And that is a function of the brain's plasticity. We also really take advantage of the fact that the part of the brain that we're working with is not the prefrontal lobe, not the neocortex, not the part of the brain that is all about complex, linear, analytical thinking. That is a part of the brain that we want to pretty much ask to stand down, to silence, to anesthetize so it's tranquil. We're working with the limbic system, the midbrain, the chemical brain, the emotional brain, and that particular part of the brain sees time or experiences time in a very different way than the linear, sequential, chronological time of the prefrontal lobe. And because of that, combined with neuroplasticity, we can work with the circuitry in such a way that we can do work in the present moment, in real time, and the limbic system, the emotional part of the brain, which also controls the autonomic nervous system, et cetera, it doesn't know whether you're doing the work to enhance the circuitry, the neuronal pathways that are healthy and serve us, and invite to atrophy those pathways that do not serve us, because the limbic system sees in a time that is different and doesn't know that we're doing this at 5 years old or living this experience at 10 years old or 20 or 30 or 40 or in real time or at 80 years old or 90 years old. We can rework the emotional content of some of the unhealthy material that's lodged, that is encoded in the circuitry. So we take maximum advantage of neuroplasticity. We work specifically with the limbic system actively. We still quell, tranquilize the complex brain, just 40% of our brain. It's what meditative practice does. It makes discursive thought, the chattering mind, linear sequential separation consciousness, which is all part of the prefrontal lobe and complex thinking. We have that, we tame that, we master that. So we tap into a much more deeper part of ourselves, and the limbic system is the doorway to that through the electromagnetic field of the heart, because it's the emotional brain, it's connected to emotion. So pillar number one, again, is an understanding that we are not material beings primarily. We are primarily non-material beings. We are primarily consciousness using the material world as a vehicle. The body, which I often call the avatar, as a vehicle for the more vast consciousness that we are. That's understanding one. Understanding two is we can work neuroplasticity of the circuitry in the human brain, the vehicle's brain, in many skillful ways to have it serve us. The third piece is deep contemplative practice and or some kind of self-observing practice. And what that does is allow us to slow our thoughts, slow our emotions, so that we can see emotions wash over us as they begin to do that. We can observe our thoughts to be able to use our tools to cut off at the pass what doesn't serve us, enhance what does serve us before we're pulled down a subjective wormhole, a vortex, and we are at the mercy of thinking that we are our thoughts, being subject to our thoughts, or being subject to emotions that ride roughshod over us. Contemplative practice allows us to gain that mastery over self. And the fourth piece is cognitive restructuring itself, which is simulations that come from an enhanced version of neurolinguistics.
Okay. So, what seems very interesting about all this is that there seems like a rather seamless integration of non-material and material of the human being, the individual. I mean, you start with the premise that we're non-material beings, and yet there is this going directly into the physical brain and working with the wiring of that brain. So it's like you've integrated both realms. Or is that a strange way of talking about it?
Well, I haven't done anything. What I'm delving into is 5,000 years old, at least in my knowledge. The Vedas, the Upanishads, the sutras, the Buddhist sutras have said this for as long as those traditions have been operative. What the only thing that shifts now is that neuroscience has finally arrived where esoteric Hinduism and Buddhism and Taoism have been 5,000 and 2,500 years respectively forever. The challenge has been that those traditions speak poetically, they speak lyrically. The texts are interpreted by teachers who speak many different languages, and if for the West, it's interpreted. There are interpreters that help people understand what's written in those documents, but it's all very poetic literature. What neuroscience has done is cut to the chase. It's basically said neuroscience, quantum science, epigenetics, neurobiology, psychoneuroimmunology have all basically gotten to where Siddhartha Gautama was 2,500 years ago and the Vedas before him 5,000 years ago. So I'm not really doing anything. I'm just using the tools that have been around for a very long time and using some of the language that is very current to say the same things that ancient teachers have been saying for a very long time. And more directly to your point, everything is energy, everything is frequency. Frequency carries information. So the beings that I am as I talk to you, the physical human being that's having a conversation, Pamela and Michael, is the same being that is an individuated unit of consciousness, which is the vast consciousness that stands at a different frequency of Michael and Pamela. And then we are also part of the quantum field. There is Michael in the quantum field. There is Michael as an individuated unit of consciousness, which is an analogy would be the individuated unit of consciousness is Michael's vastness in this, but not in fully physical form in the same way that a wave or a drop relates to the ocean. The ocean being the quantum field, the unified field, universal intelligence, God, light, spirit, whatever you want to call it, that's the ocean. And the wave or the droplet is still the ocean. It's an individuated unit that has a different frequency than the ocean, but it is still the ocean. And then moving out from that is Michael's avatar, Michael's physical being. And that's just a frequency that is at the dense vibration of the planet Earth, subject to the laws of physics, et cetera, et cetera. So it's all still Michael. So it is all always integrated, always at all times. The challenge is that when we are only focused on the physical human form, it is so seductive and so intensely everything in our society focuses our attention on only that physical form and nothing but that we lose sight of the fact that we're only in this physical form. So the larger consciousness, the individuated unit of consciousness, your attainment from embodiment after embodiment after embodiment, the vastness of who you are, Michael, as consciousness, can actually evolve exponentially faster in a dense physical problem racked environment. It's just like a diamond is created by incredible pressure. The vast consciousness that is Michael, subject to this, the vehicle that is Michael's body in this physical realm, is learning exponentially, evolving exponentially faster, because you're subject to all of the gobbledygook, the challenges and the hellishness of this environment. You can evolve faster there. But we forget that the vehicle that is Michael, the body that is Michael, is only here as a way of for Michael to get around, the more vast consciousness of Michael to get around. And that more vast consciousness, the individuated unit, is a transparent conduit for the quantum field. So all of those three, and there are many more, but just to use those metaphors, those three frequencies at which Michael exists are all integrated. It's just Michael in the physical, because this realm is so seductive, we just forget we are not in contact with a more vast piece. So the community of practice is a series of tools that keeps us perpetually in contact with that more vast part of ourselves.
Okay. I didn't realize I was so much.
You are vast, my friend.
So let's end part one here. So I think people have gotten a sense of you and what you're doing. And that can be really appealing to them or not. And part two, we'll go into more detail about this work and some of the questions that kind of generated in me during this discussion. So we'll close out for right now, and I'll be back with you in a few minutes.